right. Good to see everyone that's on the call this morning. See some familiar and unfamiliar faces. So for those of you that are new to this morning 10 o'clock call, this is my recording for my YouTube channel, Klear Channel, K-L-E-A-R Channel. I got a special guest on the call today, and I got a special guest hanging out with me here in the office. My older brother here just came into town this morning. We're all going to the U.S.-Mexico World Cup qualifier here in Cincinnati tonight. So we're going to hang out. I'm in Corey's office and Michael's office in Cincinnati. And then we're going to have some fun this afternoon. And hopefully, I'm hopeful the U.S. is going to win tonight and take another step closer to get to the World Cup. So before we get started, I know I see some familiar and unfamiliar faces. So this is my obviously YouTube channel. It's my helpless plug to get more subscribers. So if you haven't subscribed yet, and I see some people in Spartan Direct in Alathea's office in the Carolinas, I see you guys on today. So I need you guys to pull out your cell phone. Alathea, make sure everybody pulls out their cell phone. Go to YouTube. I see you guys in Columbus. I see Adrian's office there. There's got to be some newer guys in there that got to pull out their cell phones. Type in K-L-E-A-R channel on YouTube. I know you guys have a YouTube little app on your phone because you go there and watch other things. And subscribe. And listen, I'm not asking you to subscribe because I want the subscribers. I'm asking you to subscribe because I want to help. I've frankly been through a lot, and not just in business, but in life. And want to help you guys achieve and accomplish. You know, our mission and our goal on this channel is to help change the world one leader at a time. So if there's something we go over today, something we go over in general that can help you have a better day, have a better life, I know it's going to help you grow, and it's going to be a ripple effect, and we can do good. So with that said, we got a special guest today, Rich Dinella, a very good friend of mine on the call. I'm going to pin your video, Rich. And we're going to get to know you a little bit. So it's just going to be me and you chatting away and kind of getting started. So I've known Rich for a few years since he was a young owner in the business. My most fond memories of Rich were out in San Diego when he shared office space with the now Sarah Lear. My wife, when she was running offices in her early years in business, and I was just, you know, we had lived in Temecula. She drove an hour south to San Diego. I drove an hour north to Rancho Cucamonga. And we had some really good times in PB, in Pacific Beach, and going out in the, is it the Gas Lamp District, San Diego? Is that what it was called, Rich?
Yeah, that's exactly what it was.
Remember that?
Yeah.
Well, I don't remember a lot of it, but we had a good time. So just to kind of tell you a bit of his background, he grew up in Philadelphia, graduated in 2005 with a CIS degree, Computer Information Science, started in the business back in June of, let's see, what year is that? You're 22 years old,
Rich? 05 when I started.
Okay. And he's worked on ran offices since the age of 22 years old when he became an entrepreneur. And he's run offices in 7 or 8 different markets. He's now married, has a newborn, Luca, 7 months old at home. So life's changed a little bit since we met back in the day for both of us. But Rich, do you mind sharing just a little bit of your career and our organization and our business?
Yeah.
And we have obviously some questions that we want to talk about.
100%. Well, I appreciate, Ken, you having me, and it's, good to see, obviously everybody on the screen, most faces I don't know. So I appreciate you guys having me. It's an honor. And one of the things I always loved about our industry is these opportunities, right? Being in an environment where we have endless amounts of resources, that will jump on a call, at the drop of a dime, to pay it forward and share their story to hopefully impact and influence someone that's on this call. And I always appreciate it because, the more I heard other people's stories and their journey, my mentality in life has always been, if someone else can do it, I know I can do it. That mindset has evolved a little more to, I'm not better than anyone, but I'm equally as good as everyone. And, I hope today through the message and story that you guys hear, I'm able to kind of empower you to, to maybe go for your goals a little bit further. So once again, I'm Rich Dinella. I grew up in the Philly area. Everything Ken just mentioned is pretty accurate. I went back to San Diego not too long ago for an organizational trip and kind of like life, as much as things change, things don't change as well in some ways. So, you know, I started back in the field. I did business to business initially. So I was on Quill, selling office supplies, really, you know, I always like to say I was slinging some ink and toner business to business. And that's kind of how the journey started for me. It took me about a year to get promoted into management role where I did become an entrepreneur. I was 22. And obviously being 22, learning how to run a business and learning how to become really just an adult evolving was something that obviously I figured out over time. I ran offices in different markets, like Ken mentioned. I was started in Philadelphia. Then I went to Houston, Texas. Then I went to Scottsdale, Arizona. Then I went to San Diego, then San Francisco, then Boston, then New Jersey, now back to Philly. So made a big, you know, loop around the country. And been on, I think it's like 17 different clients at this point. So, you know, been number one on probably every campaign that I've been on, been dead last on every campaign. So I know what it's like to get your butt kicked and do the butt kicking. So I prefer the butt kicking for sure. So yeah, it's a little bit about me and my journey through the business.
Well, it's funny. I see the jerseys behind you, right? I see the Cunningham jersey, Allen Iverson jersey behind you. So it's, you know, I remember, I don't know if it was an ESPN reel or YouTube video where Allen Iverson says, practice. What about practice? I don't practice. Sure. Right. But so clearly it takes practice to be, you know, good in sales, to be good in leadership. Anything. So in your early years in sales, what did you do to kind of build your confidence and to build your habits and your ability in a sales capacity?
Yeah, well, you know, I'll share this to start. If anybody's never really done sales before, and this is your first career in sales, you know, join the club, right? And if you got started and you felt pretty uncomfortable in sales, you know, once again, join the club. And the one thing I've learned, you know, just through sports, you know, I played college baseball, and, you know, I've always learned that when things were uncomfortable or you're being challenged, it's really good for your growth. So I always had that in the back of my mind when I was starting sales, like walking into a business unannounced, worried about what the customer is going to say back to me versus what I needed to say to them. And then if anyone's ever done any business work, sometimes you walk into an office and it's like a doctor's office and there's a reception area and you're pretty much like putting on a show for everyone else to watch. Right. So I had so many, just like, I would say a lack of self-confidence initially of that process. The thing I always leaned on was I work hard enough, I continue to be a student, and I continue to push myself out of my comfort zone, I would get good at it eventually. So I think a lot of it was just sports mentality. And I think, you know, Ken, one thing I always did a very good job of is just surrounding myself around the right people. You know, I look around and I think one of the biggest reasons why people become successful in sales or anything in life, and the reasons why people don't, is who you surround yourself with. You know, so I come back every single day, you know, regardless of my results, kicking butt or not, always looking to get better. And I'd find someone that was kicking butt and I'd go, hey, you know, really quick, here goes what happened today. Here goes some decision makers I had. Here goes why I closed them or why I didn't. What would you say here? How would you overcome this objection? What would you be doing differently? And really one of two things would happen. Either A, they'd say, hey, you're on the right track. And that was building my confidence. Or B, they'd say, hey, try this a little bit different. And it was giving me new ideas to evolve in the field. So I'd say a lot of it just came down to being a good student, going to the people that were getting the results done, getting the results that I wanted, as well as the managers. Because once again, if they can do it, I know I can do it. So it was just a matter of if I was going to do the work or not, which I was willing to do.
And it's interesting you talk about that, that the review of the day, right? Mm-hmm. The kind of gaining awareness on what went well and what didn't go well. And there's a lot of, you know, there's journals that I've written in over time. And that's one of the, you know, end of the day journal is, okay, just kind of objective view. What did I like about my day? What do I need to change about my day? What were some wins about today? So you can build your confidence. And then, hey, what are some things that I want to work on tomorrow? So, and I know we have a culture and for any of the leaders on the call, I personally would reach out to some of my new guys and just to provide support, to provide an outlet to improve. But as a leader growing up, I was the one making the calls. I had this like desire just to do well early. So very cool. And, over time, you mentioned surrounding yourself with the right people. You've had a chance to connect and, make connections with different people inside and outside of our business. Who's made the kind of biggest impact on you as you different stages of your career, maybe someone in the business outside of your business?
Yeah, I love our business for that reason, the mentorship and the development. Think about it. I came in at 21. I come from a middle-class family. My dad was a painter for the city of Philadelphia. My mom worked in the corporate world. I would say this could be a false statement, but I feel pretty confident saying it. I doubt that they made $100,000 at any point of their careers combined. And I share this with you because coming into the business, I wasn't surrounded by entrepreneurs. I wasn't surrounded around leaders. I wasn't surrounded around people that think big. So I think initially just coming in, I was like overwhelmed and blown away by all the people in our business that seemed like they had it all figured out. I'd meet people like Ken. I'm like, Ken, thinks so big. Ken, just seems like he's, been, an entrepreneur since he's been in his diapers, right? He seems so great at it, right? And what I learned was that most people developed it over time. And I think our business is beautiful because mentorship is ingrained in our culture. I would say two things, Ken, when I think of mentors, though. One, I would say one of my biggest mentors would be, Jimmy or Matt Osborne. I started in Jim Rothamel's office back in 2005. I saw him as a single guy, running a business for a few years and then watching him evolve over the course of time into a great business owner, a consultant, a great husband, a great family man now with two kids. And the same thing with Matt. So I'd say those two initially were probably the biggest impact, and they still have the biggest impact. I would say a little more recent, a couple of years ago, I got an opportunity. One of our coaches and mentors in our business, Majeski, took me to a meeting with this guy named Ben Weiss. And if you guys don't know the name, he's the founder that created the drink by BAI. It's like the healthy kind of like not vitamin water. I don't even know what kind of drink, what category.
Isn't that his neighbor? His neighbor.
Yeah, it's his Princeton. Neighbor.
Yeah. I know. Yeah. Okay. I know.
And he wound up selling that company for like $1 billion, something to Dr. Pepper. And then he's doing the same thing with a company called Crook and Marker, which is a spiked seltzer company. And I may have had a few spiked seltzers in my time. So therefore I have a general interest in it. But Jim took me into a meeting with them once and I was so blown away, even though I didn't know the guy so well, it made a really big impact for two reasons when I met this guy. When I walked in his house where he was having his meeting, it was him, his right-hand man, Jim, and then me. And I'm like, well, this is a pretty cool environment to be in, right? I'm just like, a young guy, a couple years ago, growing a business. And these guys just sold the company for $1 billion and I'm in the same room. And you should have saw, like, they had this big map. They had all these whiteboards, like, in one of their living rooms. And it was like a war room. And they were just thinking about how they're going to grow this company and how many markets they're going to expand into and how it starts with the Spike Seltzer and eventually it's going to evolve. And what was so, what was so cool for me was just seeing the thought process and how big they thought, right? Because when they were thinking about it with Spike Seltzer, if you follow Crooked Marker now, they got like a coconut, like Spike Seltzer line. They have an iced tea Spike Seltzer line. Like they have so many different categories. And I saw that from them talking about it when it was, when it's, first getting started. The second thing that I love, which was so impressive, is this guy, Ben, is a billionaire. And he was sitting there asking me questions and asking me advice on sales and coaching salespeople, like for 45 minutes, like getting grilled by a billionaire. And I'm like, this feels really good that he's asking me questions. Maybe I do have some great things to say here, but someone that, obviously has done that well to still be that great of a student of all types of people, challenged my thought process on who are you learning from? You can learn from the newest guy in a room, someone that's obviously done great, and just ask more questions. And if you ask more questions, you'll learn a ton. So that made a big impact, even though that meeting was probably an hour or two that I got to hang out with him.
That's awesome. I remember Majeski telling me that they went to like the NBA finals together or something, and I mean, obviously that guy building that company, and it started small, huge investments, got it off the ground. Then Dr. Pepper buys them. I mean, it's like, oh man, you know, and Majeski flew with him in his private jet and all this other stuff. And it's nuts. Very cool. The, you know, if you were to start over today, your career, you've built a great organization. You got obviously a beautiful family. What would you say to yourself, 22-year-old Rich, you know, 10, 15 years later, would you say to yourself?
Have a few less spiked seltzers along the way.
No, I'm joking. You were going to say that.
Yeah. I'm joking.
Don't drink as much. Okay, cool. Yeah. What else?
Now, I would say two things when I think of this. I think one thing I did really well, which I didn't even know I was doing well, right? But looking back, I'm like, huh, that makes a lot of sense. And then something that I feel like I had to learn over time. The first thing I would say is you have to commit. In anything in life that you're going to do, you got to make a decision to commit and go for it and see it through all the way. You know, because I get a question a lot, and people are like, you promoted to assistant manager in 7.5 months. You opened up your own office in a year. How'd you do it so fast? In my mind, it was like, it wasn't so fast. This is what people told me I should have done, right? But when I look back and I'm like, well, if I consider it fast compared to other people, why? And it's because all I thought about every single day, every waking moment was getting promoted to management. There was just nothing that was going to get in the way of that. Every single day I would get in and write down my goals about why I was going through the field and why I wanted to get promoted and why it was so important to become successful. Every single day. And I watch so many people come in. And I like giving this example because people can relate, and they treat our business and really anything, right? You can treat your health, you can treat relationships, you can treat anything we're talking about like this, but you know, I'm related to our business. People come in and treat our business like it's a pool, right? And if you're anything like me at a pool, I got a pool in my backyard. And even though I have my own pool, I still go and I dip my foot in the water. And it feels too cold, I go, I ain't ready yet. Like, no way. I'm going to sit down in the sun a little bit longer. And then I'm the guy that goes down the steps, right? And I take a foot down. I'm like, ooh, this is cold. And I get a little bit warmer. I'm like, I go down another one. I'm like waist high. And then eventually I'm like, whatever. And I wind up jumping in, right? But it's like, why go through that whole process when you're just going to jump in anyway? So I watch people so often go, well, I don't know if this business is for me. I don't know if I want to do sales. I don't know if I want to be a manager. I don't know if I want to be an entrepreneur. And the answer is, you don't need to know. Just commit to seeing it through, and you'll figure it out along the way. So I think I did a really good job of that. And looking back, I think that helped in a lot of areas of my life. And I have other areas that I didn't have that same mindset, and it didn't play out the same way. The second thing I would say that I learned, Ken, that I think is really, really important, is accountability to yourself. So I've developed a mindset that everything happens for you. Nothing happens to you. Mm-hmm. Right? Like I got family members that'll say stuff like, I don't understand why I always get sick. This always happens to me. And I want to say it's not happening to you. It's happening for you and because of you, because no offense, you eat like crap and you don't move your body very often. So therefore it's happening for you. I know that's not what you want, but that's why it's happening. And I think I wish I developed a level of accountability, as strong as it is today, earlier on, because, you know, there was times I played the victim card. It was my territory. My new guy just had personal things going on. It wasn't that, you know, it wasn't me, it was them. And, you know, I built this team and the team's no longer here just because people aren't strong enough, right? And I realized that all the reasons why I'm becoming successful are because of me. And every reason that I'm not hitting my goals are for me. And one of my favorite quotes is, everyone is self-made, but only the successful admit it. And I love that, right? Because everyone that's successful loves taking the credit because you know what went into it. And everyone that's not, it's easy to point the finger. So I had to learn that.
So interesting. So interesting. That's awesome. You know, I was thinking about, Rich, when you were saying that was just, I mean, obviously I've known you as the young Rich and you know, the having a good time, having a a great business. You've always had a great business and great people around you. But now I see you've matured. Like you just started a clothing. Would you consider a clothing line? I mean, what?
It started with a message that I was looking to get out just to the world, which is look for the good. And what's interesting, Ken, is I'm sure you've done this core value exercise with Ken before.
Yeah.
And for a very long time, I'm like, I'm so optimistic. I'm so positive. I don't get why. And I did this core value exercise, and after going through it, I realized my number one core value is hope. And I'm like,
nice.
That makes a lot of sense why I do and operate the way I do. And I'm like, well, why am I always so hopeful? And it's because I believe that I always look for the good. I always look for the positives in all situations. Now, in some of the most negative situations, there's good there. You just got to look a lot harder, right? You got to look a lot harder, I promise you. But it's there if you're looking for it. And what happened, Ken, was, the pandemic hit, and clearly it was a tough time on, lots of people. And I'm like, everyone's focused on the negative. How do I just start getting this message out to just try to get people to think more of looking for the good in some of these tough times? And then so on, people would ask me, they're like, that's a great message. It's been making a great impact on me. And they'd say, do you have any apparel? And I'm like, well, I didn't really think about running another business. Running one business is challenging enough at times.
Yeah.
I'm like, but let me do it. So, I developed t-shirts and hats, and I got masks for, the pandemic purposes. And it is something that I've developed over time. Yeah.
And the company is Look for the Good.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Look for the Good. Awesome. And I know you and I talked a little bit about, and we're going to talk later about how to, maybe get that thing bigger. And I have some ideas for you just as a friend, but I think that's awesome, and it is, to your point, in life, it's really hard sometimes when you feel like the world's on your shoulders, you feel like, things not going your way and things are happening again and whatever. It's so hard to see the good. And I know I always kind of have said to myself, after I got through this really rough part of my life, was that there's a reason why God is putting this pressure on me. There's a reason why. There's something that I need to change. There's something I need to evolve. Something I need to become a better human being if I'm not accomplishing or succeeding or having the relationships that I want to have. And so to take that inside-outside approach is really, really hard. It's the last thing most people want to do, because then you start to look at yourself and you're like, man, I am the problem. But the cool thing is, to your point, is you're also the solution too. You're the reason why it is going to work for you and get better. So awesome. So tell me about your goals now. Tell us about you're in Philly, you're a new dad. Are you guys sleeping yet?
Well, it's interesting. I think there's periods of times where we were sleeping. And he got a tooth or two, right? And it's like sleep went opposite way, and then it got back on track, and now he's teething again. So I would say
teething, that's the worst.
Yeah, it's hit or miss.
So what? Tell us about our goals now. Obviously, I know we talked briefly the other day. Hyper focused on building your organization right now and your business. What are some things you're looking to do in the near future? This year, next year, and upcoming? I know you're running multiple, programs sometimes. So tell us about it.
Yeah. So, when I think of goals, it's interesting. Someone asked me recently, said, how have your goals evolved over time? Like what stayed the same, what changed? And what's interesting is my goals have changed over time based off of me changing as a human being, right? And my values changing. But in some ways they've stayed the same, right? Like things I really love is one of my favorite things that motivates me is, experiences with the people that I love the most, right? So like that motivates the hell out of me. So my wife and I are planning a trip with me, her, Luca, and her parents to go to Ireland in April, right? So, my wife and I haven't traveled a ton out of the country. Our first trip together was to go, we went to England for, it was like 8 days, and we just did different parts of England. Our second trip in Europe was Italy, which I can talk about that later. I think you might have a question about trips. That was probably my favorite trip.
Yeah.
And then, and then obviously this trip to Ireland. So, some of it is based around experiences. Some of the experiences I'm looking for next year is Ireland. I'm going to do the Kentucky Derby with my organization. That's another goal of mine.
You do that pretty often, right? Kentucky Derby.
We do different things every year. So we didn't go to Kentucky Derby yet. The year we planned it, the pandemic hit.
Oh, okay. So I had heard everything. I, yeah. Okay.
We had everything going on around it. So there are two big things from like a travel and experience standpoint that I love. The second thing I would say this year is promote three outside deals personally, right? Promote three more offices that I'm able to return an opportunity to, you know, I'm going to be opening up, you know, my system manager, Tim, in the next 2 to 3 weeks. We're just waiting for corporation papers to come through. And then I'm looking for a minimum of two more people to get promoted next year, as well as our organization really building, getting to a point where we got 15 offices through the organization. So there's some of the business goals I have, you know, from that standpoint, Ken. When I think long-term though, you know, my goals of really, you know, the biggest goal, my kind of my mission is twofold, right? You know, when I think of this look for the good mentality, you know, the reason why it's so important to me is to teach people through hope they can achieve anything they want. Like, that's my mission behind it. And when I think of that, that's personally and professionally, right? Like, I think of how do I provide that example for Luca and you know, the next child that we, you know, potentially have, and be that hope and inspire them to go for their goals. You know, one of my goals long-term is I want to coach high school baseball. I think I can make a big impact on, you know, high school students, you know, as they're starting to develop and mature. You know, as an organization, my goal is to develop 12 millionaires in our organization. So to me, a lot of it's ingrained in how do I impact, influence, and come through for people, both personally, you know, to the community, and then also in business now.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, I know it's 10:28. We really appreciate you getting on this morning. I kind of squeezed a little bit of time out of your schedule today early in the week. So I just want to say thank you, Rich. Obviously, you've had an awesome career. And, you know, just like both of us, we've had great years. We've had off years. I mean, that's entrepreneurship. It's a roller coaster. And it's just great to see you win, you know. And obviously, I know you're incredibly happy with your family and being a dad, and nothing cooler. In my opinion, but besides being an Eagles fan, and I'm a Redskins fan, that's the only thing I don't like. But you're from Philly, you're like my college roommates, and it just is what it is. We can still be friends, just not when they play.
Yeah, we're the battle of the NFC last place. We ain't gonna worry about anything.
Yeah, exactly. So we have the worst record, and you guys are just battling for that too. It's all about draft picks now.
That's it.
All right. Well, hey, thanks so much, Rich. If we could take our phones or our computers or whatever off of mute and say thank you, I'd really appreciate it. But have an amazing day, everybody. Rich, thank you so much for the time. And we'll talk to you guys next time.